Hi there and welcome back to the Nourishing Roots channel, where I aim to show you how to develop a more positive relationship with food and body and ultimately aim for recovery from your eating disorder. Now in this week's video, I'm really passionate about talking about how to distinguish your ED voice or your eating disorder voice from your authentic voice. And this is a really challenging topic in recovery, because how the hell do we distinguish between two things that can sometimes sound exactly the same? So, for example, you might find that when you're sat down challenging yourself with a meal, you might feel, or a snack, you might feel as though, I don't want that, that's not what I like, and I'd actually prefer to have a salad or something, you know, a little bit healthier. I don't like things that are as stodgy or as calorie dense. And you might genuinely believe that that is you talking. Similarly, you might wake up in the morning, look at the weather outside and think, you know, it's raining, but I'm going to go for a walk or a run anyway, because I'm such an exercise type of person and it's really good to keep myself healthy and fit. But if we actually dig a little bit deeper into those details, your voice may sound the same as your own voice, but that's actually an eating disorder voice. But the reason it sounds the same is because you think you've suffered with this illness for maybe a number of months or even years. That ED voice over time has kind of got the same accent as you now. It's allowed itself to have the same voice tone, and ultimately it does sound as though you yourself are speaking. So you might say to yourself, oh, I don't want a snack at this time, it's way too late to eat a snack. Or, you know what, I've gone past the time I'd normally want to eat a meal, so I'll just skip it or have something less. And you might be going along la-di-da on your normal day and think that's completely normal, but you know what, it absolutely isn't. And somewhere in your mind, deep down, there is something that is on self-sabotage mode that doesn't belong there. So I like to think of this, it's like a voice or a little person inside that's been fed over and over the years the permission to stay in your mind, and it's fed by giving in to the eating disorder voice. So every time you dismiss the eating disorder voice as being your own, you kind of allow it permission to stay there, and eventually it's kind of become like a little inmate. It's become your partner, well, your partner in crime really, because all it wants to do is sabotage you and kid you into thinking that you are making the best choice for yourself, when actually, ultimately, it wants you to die. And that might sound a little bit drastic, but let's be honest, that's where the end point is for most eating disorders. And it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to have lost a drastic amount of weight to have an eating disorder, because ultimately, this little voice inside is malnourishing you, not only of food, but of life opportunities, of joy, of experiencing new things in the world. And it's keeping you living in a minute sized world that's probably the size of a small, you know, sugar-free cracker. And if we think about living a life that small, that's not really giving you justice. So to get back to the whole point of this video, I think it's so vitally important to recognise when the ED voice is speaking and when you are speaking, because often they're entirely different things that simply sound the same. So let's get going with the topic a little bit more deeply. So first, I'd like to say a good way of distinguishing between which voice is yours and which is the ED voice, especially when you're coming to choose a snack or a meal, is to ask yourself, if you're stuck between two or more options, would I choose that if in 10 years time I wanted to lead a full life? And often the case is no. So I'll give you an example. If I was going to a local coffee shop for a snack, I would often either bring a safe snack with me, or I'd look on the menu and my eyes would instantly be drawn to the lowest calorie thing on the menu and say, I want to choose that. That is definitely the best option to take. Or I'd do a little bit of research and go, oh, which is the healthiest one? That has more nuts and seeds in it and grains, so I'll choose that one quickly. And it was like a matter of impulse, but I really believed that I was speaking from my own heart and ability to recover. But in reality, I was trying to choose the safest option based on what my ED voice is telling me. However, what I did learn to do over time was just step back for a moment and say, you know, if I want to live my life, in 10 years' time, would I choose that option? Like, does that, you know, minuscule little granola bar that tastes like cardboard, is that really going to give my future life any justice? Or if I was a happy and fulfilled adult, is that what I would really choose? You could also frame it in the context of, if I was going out with friends, family, or even my future children, and I wanted to buy us all a snack that we could share together, would I choose that horrible, crappy option? And the answer will probably be no. Another way you can actually try this kind of concept of separating the voice and realising what you want and what the ED wants is to maybe look at two different options that you're weighing up. Maybe one is a muffin and the other one is a healthy snack bar. So the ED voice goes, oh, I think you should choose the granola bar because it's full of fibre, it has one of your five a day in it, or part of a bit of fruit in it. It might look like it's going to keep you fuller for longer. It might say, oh, normal healthy people eat that one and only fat gluttonous people eat muffins, which by the way is an absolute lie. And you might go, well, quickly, out of fear of being judged by myself really, I'm going to choose the granola bar. However, what you can do is say, I'm going to imagine that these two snack items have no calories in whatsoever, which is a hard task to do. Just imagine for a second that none of them have any calories and it really doesn't matter what you eat. Imagine that they're both the same in health terms, vitamins, minerals, whatever. And go, actually, what would, you can say your name here, so I'll say mine. What would Marissa want right now? What do I genuinely feel like having? And you might realise that, hell no, it's not the cardboard granola bar. It's also not the safe snack that I've brought in my bag. And just to give you a little bit of an insight into my own personal circumstances, I used to carry something called naked bars around me all the time. And I would literally buy boxes and boxes of them offline because they were my safe snacks and my go-to. And I kidded myself for years thinking that I loved these snack bars. They were so nice, they tasted really sweet, they go well with a cup of tea. I even did a review about them. And oh my God, I tasted one of these a few weeks ago that I just had left in my cupboard just by chance. And I was like, ugh, these, they're okay. They're not disgusting, but they are no means the nicest snack to choose from sometimes. And also, because I used to rely on them so much, I used to become obsessed with trying new flavours of them. And I knew the flavours so well that I could pick up on when the ingredients list changed. But my eating disorder voice was so adamant that I loved these bars that it made me keep buying them. Now, years later, I know for a fact that naked bars, some of them are okay. They're basically made of dates and nuts and a little bit of natural flavouring. But God damn it, sometimes I really prefer to just go to Starbucks, order a cookie, a granola bar, a brownie. And you know what? Yeah, maybe I might have a healthy snack at another point during the day. But at least once a day, or twice, or three times a day, I prefer to have snacks that are made with real sugar, real carbohydrates, well, you know what I mean, not the annoying things that are gluten-free if you don't have an allergy to that. And, you know, just being free to make a choice that actually is in line with your mental hunger and physical hunger, which again are sometimes two completely different things. It's also good to ask yourself whether you are just eating something for health reasons rather than taste. And another example of this, similar to the naked bar situation, is that because I fell into, I don't want to say fell, but I was vegan for quite a few years during my recovery. And personally looking back now, I think it was not the right decision to take at the time because it ultimately involves still having food rules and picking things based on that's the most ethical choice, rather than because it was what I wanted to eat. And unfortunately, it also sucked me into this whole movement of plant-based eating, healthy eating, having to eat the, you know, the purest item on a menu, or even order from abroad these snacks that had like protein in them, this vegan protein. And I spent so much money on vegan food. And I always made a decision to try and pick the healthiest or most ethical option. And an example, I used to always eat. Like, if I'd ordered something and it came with a little bit of salad and some raw vegetables, or let's give an example, raw tomatoes and raw peppers, I kidded myself for years that, yeah, I love raw tomatoes and raw vegetables. They're so nutritious and taste so nice and sweet. And even if my friend or boyfriend didn't finish their vegetables on their plate, I'd feel compelled that I had to eat them because that was, you know, I'm getting more health in my body. But now I've realised, even over the last few weeks, I do not like raw tomatoes. There, I've said it. I've come out of the closet, but I just don't like raw vegetables. I don't like raw carrots, raw tomatoes, raw peppers, or whatever other vegetable, unless it's, let me find something, maybe sweet corn or chickpeas, but I prefer cooked vegetables, even if it means that, God forbid, I'm going to have less vitamins and minerals for that day or meal. This is just kind of to give you a bit of a picture of, like, learning to understand what part of you is making the choice. Is it the eating disorder part that has, you know, managed to miraculously change its own voice to sound like yours? Is it your own voice, though, that really wants you to actually challenge yourself a little bit more? Because that's also an important voice to listen to. So for me, sometimes I would really, really fancy something off the menu, like a muffin. And I used to be so scared of muffins for absolutely no reason, because muffins are not bad food. And I'd try and say to myself, oh yeah, go on, Marissa, have that muffin. You know, it'd really help you in recovery. But then there's this other voice, oh no, there's been plenty of other times to eat that. Eat that when you're maybe with someone else to share it with. You don't need to eat a full muffin. Who eats a full muffin? And it would give me this long list of things why I shouldn't have the muffin. And at the time, that voice seemed so much louder than the voice that had said, had the muffin. And here's the way to distinguish that. So just by the pure fact that that voice sounded louder, I could probably 99.9% of the time guarantee that that was the eating disorder voice. It was a voice that, you know, even though it sounded like me, it was a little bit more vicious. It was a little bit more forceful. It had a little bit of an edge of fear to it. So it was very threatening, and it sounded as though, oh, you know, Marissa, if you eat that muffin, then this will happen and you'll be fat and you'll be disgusting and you won't be worth anything as a person. And then when I started to realise that although this voice sounded the same, it actually had a very different personality and a different kind of persona about it in general. It just wasn't very compassionate. And then I thought, actually, Marissa is compassionate, but why is that other part of me not? And I was like, it's like unveiling the mystery person that, oh my God, under this kind of twin that I viewed as myself is actually this little gremlin with teeth and claws and looks really ugly and nasty. And you go, oh my gosh, how have I lived with that? Telling me what to do? How dare it, like, look like me and sound like me and make me do things that I don't want to do? It's like a cult. You get drawn in this cult that feels so natural, and it's your authentic motivation to be part of that cult. But eventually you realise, no, it wasn't. It's not you. It's not who you were born to be. And most of the decisions you've been making have been making on self-sabotage mode rather than real recovery mode. Now, before I sum up this video, there's also another example of what I wanted to give you. And this one's based more around exercise rather than food. So if you feel sometimes compelled to even just go on a walk around the block, and you know that, you know, there's really no need to, but you're kind of convincing yourself, I need to get that walk in because I always walk at that time of day. I always need to walk this many steps a day, and I just feel like I need to move. Stop and ask yourself, honestly, am I okay with the idea of not exercising? And I think personally, only when you're okay with the idea of not exercising, should you be okay with the idea of pushing yourself to do more exercise. Because this is a fine line balance. And I didn't realise this for a long, long time. I thought that my daily walks weren't really exercise and just a natural, healthy thing that people who want to keep the fitness up do. But what I realised one day when it was chucking it down with rain, it was really windy outside, and, you know, only a crazy person would have stepped out in that gale force wind, I realised that, hang on, I cannot sit here and not exercise. I felt like this vicious thing had jumped on my shoulder and telling me I needed to move. Now, that is not a compassionate reason for exercising at all, and that is 100% your eating disorder voice controlling whether you should exercise or not. So, again, hitting down on that point, only exercise, even if it's just a few walks around the block per day, but it's compulsively, stop doing that and only engage in organised movement when you're completely, say at least 99% okay with the fact of having a lazy pyjama day or sitting inside all day and not having to go for a walk. And personally, this is something that I can still struggle with sometimes because I sometimes feel like I just need to move. But I'm not going to kid myself that I'm naturally an active person or I'm a person who needs to keep fit all the time. I'm just not. That is coming from the eating disorder voice. And it's really important to distinguish that. Otherwise, you're going to go on this lifelong journey of self-sabotage, not knowing who's who. And before you know it, you'll be 50 or 80 years of age even, thinking, oh my God, how have I lived with this abusive partner for so long? And that is exactly what it is. It is an abusive partner that doesn't want you to feel loved or wanted or worthwhile or good or even healthy, to be honest. It's using that as a whole mask. Because deep down, this eating disorder voice is only fueled by fear. And if we get to the root of it, the only reason it's developed is because it's part of our kind of growing up self who always feared that it wasn't enough, it wasn't worthy, it was a disgusting person, or it needed to be slim and healthy in order to be loved. And when you reassure that voice that it's loved unconditionally and first and foremost by yourself, you can give it permission to leave and get lost out the door. Go and let it go on its own journey of recovery and not yours. You deserve so much more to be trapped in this cycle of listening to yourself, listening to the eating disorder voice, listening to what everyone else wants around you. Just centre yourself and understand where you are coming from. You know that deep down there's a massive part of you that wants recovery. Even if the eating disorder voice, when you recognise it, says that slim is safe, healthy food's safe, stay in this small bubble of a restricted world is safe. Because familiar, even when it can lead to death, is often still perceived as safe. So when you distinguish between the two, it's so important to, regardless of how horrible it feels, is to choose your voice. Not the eating disorder, but your voice. Even if it's saying, I'm hungry after feeling physically full after a meal, go and eat something. Even if it's just a cracker, a biscuit, some piece of toast lathered with butter, and who cares how much. Honour your authentic voice in recovery, because the more you honour it, the louder it grows, the more personality it develops, in order so it can get so strong and so big that it can punch your other eating disorder voice in the face so it leaves for good. And you know what, there will be a point where ultimately it leaves you for good. Yeah, you might know that you'll never go on a diet again just in case you trigger it to come back or go on some crazy health routine or exercise regime, but you know that your voice is ultimately in control and that is the most important thing. So again, without me blabbering on too much with this video, which is something I'm really passionate about, I just invite you to just have a bit of reflect on what is your voice and what is the eating disorder voice. You could even write down the things that the eating disorder voice might say and the things that you might say, or just a general list of things that you hear in your mind, and just have a good assessment which one is me and which one is not. And when you know, you can start to circle kind of voices or kind of commandments that are more in line with what you want to do and doing the exact opposite actions of what the eating disorder is telling you to do. And yeah, it's going to be difficult, but isn't recovery a difficult process anyway? And you're going to make things a hell of a lot easier for yourself in the long run once you start to listen and be true to your authentic voice, because that is the most important. So thank you so much for listening to this video. I know I've definitely harped on a lot, but I'd really like to hear your kind of views on this and how maybe you start to tackle your eating disorder voice or distinguish between what's yours and the eating disorders, because I think it's really helpful to share that. And again, if you want to subscribe to this channel, you can do. Or if not, you might just want to come back and watch another video, and that's fine too. So hopefully I will see you soon. Have a great week and start to challenge your eating disorder voice. Bye.